Let me show you one more type of search that's possible. When you go into the tree structure here through the browser, and let me go to my beloved chemicals division here. If I take a look at child elements, you'll notice within child elements there is a search mechanism as well. And this is a search mechanism that has those same types of rules. We can decide to include children or not, specify whether it's a starts with, exact match, ends with, contains, etc. And so here, let's look for the 101, those things that have 101. If you notice, this is actually immediate. So as soon as you start typing those things in there, you'll see some search results. So let me go ahead and modify this. As you can see, depending on what you type in, you will get immediate response. I just typed in Houston, and we found one result there. So that's a, there we go. Here's all the assets that have the word reactor in them, including this Houston Reactor 101. Again, just these are different mechanisms for getting at that same thing. And once you've found that reactor that you're interested in, from here you can do a right click, choose properties, and this should look familiar. It's the same tabs we were looking at before: child elements, attributes, etc. Okay, and there we go. By double clicking on there, I've taken myself directly to that thing that I found. So that's yet another mechanism for navigation. Now, one last thing, when I'm looking at that reactor, if that reactor were to have, oh, let's say a great number of attributes, hundreds and hundreds of attributes, sometimes you'd like to filter through those attributes. So on this attribute screen, where we're seeing the different attributes of that asset, it's got a diameter, height, mass, product, etc., I can decide to filter. So if I want to filter on temperature, you can just type in temp. And again, it's an immediate search. As soon as you start typing, we'll go out and search for those things that match that search criteria. Now, there's one more major component that we haven't looked at yet within the System Explorer, and that is something I've kept hidden up to this point. It's called the palette. And when you decide to show the palette, you can choose to show either element templates or data references. Not sure what's showing up now. Yeah, we're looking at data references right now. Let me show you what I'm talking about. With this, or when we would use this. The reason I held this off to last is because it's not something that you're going to be using unless you're actively creating things. And, you know, that's a little bit more advanced than what we're doing right now. We're just learning how to navigate. So let me explain how it would work. When we decide to show the palette here, or when you decide to show the palette, this now gives you a mechanism, a drag and drop mechanism that you can use when it's time to create objects or assets, and then when it's time to further add attributes to those assets. So getting back to our example, oh, let's say we're in manufacturing in the chemicals division, we're in Houston, and we're not going to look at it from an equipment point of view, we're looking at it from a production point of view. So let's say in this reactor train, we are at the point where we're ready to add this new reactor. If I take a look at this reactor, look at its general, I can see that this is based on a template called chemical reactor. And I've decided in my palette to show the templates. There's actually two choices. We can show, whoops, that's the wrong object. I can either show data references or templates. And we'll talk more about data references in a second. But anyway, with templates selected, what I can choose to do at this point, if I would like to add a new reactor, I'm currently looking at reactor 102. Let's say I want to add reactor 103. I would just do a drag and drop. I would find this chemical reactor template from over here, and then I would click and drag and put this on whatever object needs to be the parent. And in this case, it's going to be this one right here, this reactor train. Now, we're being asked at this point to define the reference type. There's a couple of different types we'll describe later on, but the default is the parent-child. And as you can see, what this has done is it's created a new element. You know, I call it an asset, but it's basically, it's the technical term is an element. in this asset database. This element is called Chemical Reactor 1, and now I can start defining this to be what I wanted it to be, which is the Houston Reactor 103. And then, you know, I would take it from there. So this gives me, this palette gives me an option to do a drag and drop to create new elements. Yeah. So, you know, if you're primarily going to be looking, I would say you're going to use this, you know, 1/100th as much as you would use all the other elements here. That's why we saved it for last. And speaking of not using it frequently, here's something you'll probably use even less, and that is the ability to drag and drop new attributes onto this particular element. If I switch over to data references, if I want to add a new data reference, like these are all data reference, or excuse me, these are all attributes here, and these attributes have specific data references. This can be a reference to a Pi point, or to a formula, or to a lookup in our table that will actually go out to a relational database. In any event, and we'll talk more about data references later on, in any event, I can drag and drop these over here to add new attributes. Actually, I can do that if my template upon which this is based supports that. Now, this is getting into some obscurities here, but let me show you. Now, remember, when I created this, this was based on a template called Chemical Reactor. If I go into my library, I'll take a look at the template called Chemical Reactor. Aha, I see that if I were to try to drag and drop an attribute on there, it would not permit it because it's currently not allowing extensions. I'll go ahead and allow extensions. Now if I go back here, and if I choose my new element, I go into attributes, now I can drag and drop a new attribute on here. As you can see, it's just given the generic attribute one name. It is going to be a Pi point attribute. And again, we'll talk about more of these later on. So I really just showed you this just to explain what this palette is all about. And you know what? I think once I turn this off, that's the last we're going to see of that in this class. Because it's a nice shortcut. Hey, shortcuts are great. But you know, for the most part, we're going to be showing you how to do it the regular way, not using shortcuts. But it's available if you're interested. Well, that's just about the end of our introduction to the Pi System Explorer, so let's just kind of mop up on some features we haven't seen yet. First of all, down at the bottom, you'll see a status bar. So as I switch from one object to the next, take a look, you'll see the status bar changes depending on what's going on. For example, when we go into notifications later on or units of measure, you'll see that those type of statuses listed down there. Also, you'll find under Go, this is just a quick way to go to the different, basically the navigation pane there, so I can choose to go to elements or etc. etc. You can go choose tools to change the options. As we saw before, there's a help option. There is an option right here to create new elements and new attributes here, just a quick little shortcut. And we'll talk about check-in and check-out and query date later on. So there we go. That's your brief introduction to the Pi System Explorer.